Hello, and thank you for joining us with Redeemer's Heart Church tonight for our weekly Thursday night service. We meet at 6:30 every Thursday night at 1537 Chutney Court in Colorado Springs, Colorado. We're going to start live streaming our worship, which starts at 7 o'clock, and the teaching every night after that as well. Feel free to share this live stream with your friends on your Facebook stream, and look for us on our YouTube channel, Redeemer's Heart Church, as well. The teachings will be posted out there. We just, again, want to thank you for joining us tonight. I'm just going to share this out here real quick on the internet. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for your love and your peace and your kindness towards us, that you are for us, that you are faithful. Lord, that everything we need is found in you. You are all sufficient. You are more than sufficient, Lord. We praise you. We adore you, and we acknowledge you, Lord. Amen. 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 So let's worship the Lord together tonight, guys. Hallelujah. God and King, His love endures forever, for He is good, He is above all things, His love endures forever. His love endures forever, for the life that's been reborn, His love endures forever.
Love endures forever.
His love endures forever. His love endures forever, forever. His love endures forever. His love endures forever. His love endures forever and ever. Forever. Doesn't live here no more. When your name was spoken, your name brought healing to me. No fear doesn't live here no more. No fear doesn't live here no more. When your name was spoken, your name brought healing to me. No shame doesn't live here no more. Shame doesn't live here no more. When your name was spoken, your love brought healing to me. Condemnation no more. And lost all control, I am set free. By your glory and grace, you broke every chain, I am set free. Your name, Jesus, yes, your name, Jesus, Jesus, your name. Your name brings healing to me. Your name, yes, your name, Jesus. Your name, Jesus. Jesus, your name. Your name brings healing to me. I am free, I am free. Chains have no hold on me. I've been healed. Hallelujah. I am free. I am free. These chains have no hold on me. I've been healed. Hallelujah. Doesn't live here. No fear doesn't live here no more. No fear doesn't live here no more. Your name was spoken. Your name brought healing to me. Shame, no shame doesn't live here no more. Shame doesn't live here no more. Spoken, your name brought healing to me. Condemnation no more, sin lost all control, I am set free. By your glory and grace, you broke every chain, I am set. Your name brings healing to me. Your name, Jesus. Your name, Jesus. Jesus, your name. Your name brings healing to me. Chains have no hold on me. I've been healed. Hallelujah. I am free. I am free. These chains have no hold on me. I've been healed. Hallelujah. Chains have no hold on me. I've been healed. Hallelujah. I am free. I am free. These chains have no hold on me. I've been healed. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope secures. He will my shield and as long as life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love. Amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine. But God who called me here below will be forever mine. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love. chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior's ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace, unending love, amazing grace. Jesus, we praise you. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your gift. We thank you for you, Jesus. Your love, your name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. You are Jesus. You are Jesus. You're the Holy and Anointed One, Jesus. You are Jesus. You are Jesus. You're the risen and exalted one, Jesus. Name is like honey on my lips, spirit like water to my soul. Your word is a lamp unto my feet. Jesus, I love you. I love you. You are Jesus. Jesus, holy and anointed, holy and anointed one, risen, exalted, risen and exalted one, holy, holy and anointed one, your Jesus. You walk on the waters, you walk on the waters, you speak to the seas, you stand in the fire beside me. You roar like the lion, you bled as a lamb, you carry my healing in your hands. You are Jesus. You are Jesus. There is a truth that's older than the ages. There is a promise of things yet to come. There is one born for our salvation. He's Jesus. There is a light that overwhelms the darkness. There is a kingdom that forever reigns. There is freedom from the chains that bind us. He is Jesus, Jesus. He walks on the waters. To the seas. Call in times of trouble. There is a song that comforts in the night. There's a voice that calms the storm that rages. He's Jesus. He's Jesus. He walks on the waters. He speaks to the seas. He stands in the fire beside me. He roars like the lion. He bled as the lamb. He carries my healing in his hands. He is Jesus. He is Jesus. He is Jesus. He's the holy and anointed one. He's Jesus. He's Jesus. He is Jesus. He's the risen and exalted one. He's Jesus. Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. All sufficient sacrifice, freely given, such a price. But our redemption, heaven's gates swing wide. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, break every chain,
break every chain, to break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. All sufficient. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Yeah, yeah. There is power in the name of the Lord. There is power. There is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. You broke every chain, you broke every chain, you broke every chain. Thank you, Lord. You are the life freer and the change breaker. You break, Lord, every chain. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. We praise you. And we worship you, Lord. Hallelujah. Father, we want to thank you for your love and your faithfulness. That you're there, Lord, for us in the good times and in the bad times, Lord, that you lead us out. Thank you, Lord, that in Psalm 23, it doesn't say that we're in the valley of death. It says we're in the valley of shadow of death. That we need not fear, Lord. It's just a shadow. It's just a lie. That in you, we are victorious. In you, we are triumphant. In you, we are more than conquerors. The chains break, Lord, that lives change. Hallelujah. the name of Jesus.
Amen.
At the name of Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Amen, guys. Amen.
Praise God.
Hallelujah. Well, we have a week of church service where there is no snow, guys. Praise God and hallelujah. So that's a good thing. I'm going to plug this in real quick so we don't lose the camera during the feed, guys. Sorry about the close-up there. So we have been talking over the last few weeks about the Holy Spirit. We started off about 4 weeks ago with a discussion about the Holy Spirit and how he relates to us in different aspects of our lives. People were asking about the baptism of the Holy Ghost, what happens with the Holy Spirit when we get born again, and speaking of the baptism of the Holy Spirit, what happens when we actually get baptized? What is that all about? So after that discussion, we had a week where we just talked about the Word of God, and we set aside our belief system and said, let's let the Bible get in the way of our doctrine. Let's let the Bible get in the way of what we think about things. We're not going to base any of the following discussions on things that we've heard, on things that we assumed. We looked at Ephesians chapter 4, and we looked at Colossians chapter 2, when Paul was giving instruction talking to us about don't be children anymore, don't be tossed to and fro by winds and waves, don't let every fad or new thing in the world or Christianity or pop culture take you and sway you back and forth, but to be planted and to be planted in Christ. In fact, in Colossians chapter 2, Paul literally said, don't let yourselves be taken as spoil, as like the spoils of war, by philosophies of men or vain deceit, but base your system, base the way you think, your life philosophy, your worldview on Christ and on Christ alone. Let me bring up our notes here. After that, after we agreed to not let our previous beliefs get in the way of our doctrine and let the Bible get in the way, we started talking about the Holy Spirit. We talked about the first week, we split it up into three baptisms. The first week, the first 2 weeks, we talked about our baptism into the body, that when we become born again, that we are baptized by the Holy Spirit into the body of Christ. And before we go any further, because it's tradition, I want to start today with a couple little funnies. And they're going to be themed with what we're talking about today, having to do with baptism. So our first little story is, a little son of a Baptist minister was in church one morning when he saw for the first time the rite of baptism by immersion. He was greatly interested and the next morning proceeded to baptize his three cats in the bathtub. I agree, Edward. The first kitten bore it fairly well, and so did the young cat, but the old family cat kind of rebelled. It struggled with him, it clawed, it tore at the boy, and then it got away. With considerable effort, he caught it again and proceeded with the ceremony. But this cat acted worse than ever, clawed at him, spit, scratched his hands, his face, generally put up a fit. Finally, after barely getting the cat splattered with a little bit of water, he dropped her on the floor in disgust and said, fine, go be a Methodist. Our second story is titled Oklahoma Baptism, and I think there's one or two people watching from Oklahoma right now on the live stream, so I hope you appreciate this. So after a hearty Oklahoma rainstorm filled all the potholes in a back alley, a young mother watched her two little boys playing in a water puddle through her kitchen window. The older of the two, a five-year-old boy, grabbed his sibling by the back of the head and shoved his face straight into the water hole. As the younger boy recovered and stood laughing and dripping, the mother ran into the backyard with a panic. Why on earth did you do that to your little brother? She inquired as she shook the older boy in anger. He says, we were just playing church, Mommy. I was baptizing him like the preacher did in church last Sunday. I said, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and in the Holy Ghost. So that will give you a little bit of a key about what we're talking about today. Today we're going to be talking about water baptism. And again, yes, in the Holy Ghost. So just to recap a little bit again about first baptism that we talked about in the first 2 weeks. We talked about the Holy Spirit and how He relates to us in three different ways. We talked about how He relates to us in our baptism into the body. We talked about, and we're beginning to talk about how He relates to us in baptism in water, and then how next week He relates to us in the baptism of the Holy Spirit. We talked about basing our belief systems not off of this experience, assumption, tradition, that we're going to base it off the Word of God. When we were talking about the baptism into the body, we laid a foundation by talking about mankind's need for restoration and relationship with God. We talked about Adam ate of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, that he would surely die. Well, when Adam and Eve did eat of that tree, they didn't drop dead right then and there. And what we discovered was that what God was talking about, it wasn't an immediate physical death. It was actually a spiritual death. It was one where at that point in time, they began breaking relationship with God. In fact, Adam and Eve's response to eating that fruit, because they walked daily with God in the garden, they fellowshipped with Him daily. After they ate of the tree, they realized they were naked. They covered themselves with fig leaves. God went walking through the garden, calling out for Adam and Eve, but they hid from Him. And so many people in the church have a backwards view of that. They think that when Adam and Eve ate of that tree, that God hid His face from them. But it was the other way around. Mankind made the choice, and we separated ourselves from God. We, in that point in time, through Adam, became spiritually dead. That it wasn't a physical death, it was a spiritual one. That carried down through Adam's seed with every generation, through the seed of Adam, because he was the one that was told not to eat of that fruit. And that as we are born, we're born spiritually dead. We're born dead to God with that Adamic nature. With that, some people call it the old man, some people call it the sin nature, but it's that Adamic nature. And then Jesus came. And when Jesus came, it changed everything. The angels cried out to the shepherds, peace on earth, goodwill towards men. That wasn't talking about peace between man and man, because as we can see over the last 2,000 years, that still ain't happening, and it's not going to happen. What the angels were talking about is it was peace from God towards man, that God was bridging the gap through Jesus to bring reconciliation, restoration, and life back to mankind in regards to the relationship with God. As Jesus grew up, and after He was baptized in water, which we're going to be talking about in a little bit, and He was teaching, there was a Pharisee by the name of Nicodemus that hunted Jesus down one night and had a discussion with Him in John chapter 3 about the need for man to be born again. When Jesus told that to Nicodemus, Nicodemus was confused. He's like, what do you mean born again? I'm an adult man. Am I supposed to crawl back in my mother's womb? I mean, because no one had ever heard this term about being born again. But Jesus said that a man has to be born of water, which talks about the natural birth, and we have to be born of the Spirit, which is brought to life accepting what Jesus had done through His death, burial, and resurrection. And then in John chapter 4, we talked about the encounter that Jesus had with the Samaritan woman at the well. He described to her a water that He could provide to make her thirst no more, and that it would spring up inside her unto everlasting life. She recognized at that point in time that He was the Messiah, that He was the Savior, that He was the Christ. Right off the bat, when He started having discussions, she's like, you are a prophet. I mean, it was pretty obvious. And then she realized He was more than that. That water that Jesus was talking about was later described again in John chapter 7, verses 37 through 39. Let me read those verses real quick. Jesus said, in the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. He that believes on me, as the scripture said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. There's that water again that Jesus is talking about that's going to overflow. And then John wrote right after that in verse 39, but this spake he of the Spirit. So that water is the Spirit, which they that believe on Him, on Jesus, should receive. For the Holy Ghost was not yet given, because that Jesus was not yet glorified. So when Jesus, in John chapter 4, with the woman at the well, and when Jesus in John chapter 3 with Nicodemus talked about being born of the Spirit, what he was talking about was that Holy Spirit. Then last week we moved on and we discussed the last major encounter that Jesus had with his 12 disciples prior to his arrest, his torture, his crucifixion, called the Last Supper. He could have chosen any topic to focus on during that time. It was a time, and Jesus knew what was coming. He was trying to describe to the disciples, but they just weren't getting it. They weren't catching a clue. They couldn't see what was about to happen. Jesus knew that he was about to be crucified. Jesus knew he was about to be arrested. And during this time, this crucial last moment with his 12 closest people, he could have chosen anything to speak about. But what he kept going back to over and over and over again on 5 different times in during that time was the Holy Spirit, this Paracletos, this comforter that we discussed last week. In John chapter 14, 15, and 16, that's described. We talked about the comforter, the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit is, in Greek, it was pneuma aletheia, the Spirit of Truth. And we talked about how pneuma is a gentle wind of strong, solid, objective truth. That the Holy Spirit was a gentleman. That the Holy Spirit doesn't force himself on anybody, but he's gentle. And he's truthful. And it's not a subjective truth. It doesn't change with circumstance. He is who he is. We are who we are. And he continually reminds us of that. We talked about how he was the Paracletos, the comforter, the one who comes alongside, the one who's the advocate with the right words at the right time. That he reminds us of what we need to be reminded of, when we need to be reminded. And that Jesus covered 11 different things that the Holy Spirit was, that he's given, he's not earned. There's nothing we can do to earn relationship with God. That it's a gift, that as we believe on Jesus, we become alive to God in Christ Jesus. That he's the Spirit of Truth, that gentle breath of objective, not subjective truth. That he's not for the world, that they can't see him, they can't perceive him, they can't even truly comprehend him and what he is and who he is. That we can and we do know him. And the word that Jesus used in describing this was a Jewish idiom. It was a slang word for a husband lying with his wife in intimacy. That when we know him, that gnosko is what the word is in the Greek. It's literally that level of intimacy that he desires with us, that oneness, that trueness, that he dwells and he lives with us, that he's sent to teach us all things in the same way that whosoever believes on him in John 3:16, it's all encompassing. There's no one excluded in that when it says he's sent to teach us all things. There's nothing excluded from that. It's all encompassing. What we need to know, he can teach us. He brings to remembrance everything to be remembered that needs to be remembered, as I mentioned earlier. That he's sent not to judge the church, and this was a key for so many people, that the Holy Spirit is not sent to judge the church of sin. He's sent to remind us of our righteousness. That he guides us to all truth. He shows us things to come, what the next step is. And that he'll receive from Jesus and show it to us. We finished up by talking about how we're baptized into the body of Christ, the church, by the Holy Spirit. That Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 13, for by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body, whether we be Jews or Gentiles, whether we be bond or free, and have been made to drink into one Spirit. That the Holy Spirit is the one who baptizes us. And we are one body. Now, prior to beginning the series, we had an open discussion and a little Q&A session one night after the live stream regarding the Holy Spirit and how he relates to us. One of the areas of discussion surrounded baptism in water versus baptism in the Holy Spirit. Someone had some questions in how he relates to us. In fact, I think that person's watching on live stream right now. And that's why we're discussing the three separate baptisms referenced in the New Testament, that baptism into the body, the baptism in water, and the baptism in the Holy Spirit. And today we're going to start the baptism in water. So what is baptism? It's a lot of different words in the Greek. There's the word bapto, there's the word baptizo. And I did a little bit of a study, and an amazing thing happened that I read about in my studies. See, the Greek language dates back well before, obviously, when the Bible was written. There's large texts that have been found over the last 2,000 years of different Greek scholars and different Greek writers and thinkers that help us put the Bible in context, meaning that we can see the language that they wrote, what they meant when they used different words, like in English. And we talked about this back in springtime, the word love in English. I mean, I love cheeseburgers. I love my wife. I love my dog. I don't love cats. That's why we talked about baptizing the cats, guys. But it's like in English, we've got one word that means all of those things, but the Greeks had a deeper language. They had four different words for love. There was storge, phileo, eros, and agape. And each of them meant different things, and they're different types of love. In the same way, the word baptize or immerse or wash, there were different forms of that word in the Greek. And it was really cool because a recipe was found by a Greek scholar that was written about 100 or 200 years before the birth of Jesus on how to pickle vegetables. Now that might seem like a weird, strange thing to talk about when we're going to be talking about baptism in water, but it really relates and gives light to what Jesus was talking about and what the apostles and the writers in the New Testament were talking about every time they talked about baptism. Because in the Greek, there's one word to wash your hands or to cleanse something temporarily. That word is bapto, B-A-P-T-O. It's a temporary cleansing. And there's another word in the Greek for immersing something, and that's baptizo. See, in this recipe that this Greek scholar, because he was trying to teach people how to save food, he was trying to teach them how to preserve vegetables. I mean, it's just a recipe on how to pickle vegetables. But it opens up the scripture to us. Because what he said in the recipe is when you take your vegetable, you have to bapto it in boiling water. You have to clean it temporarily to make sure it's clean. It's just a temporary cleansing. And once you've baptoed the vegetable, then you baptizo it in the vinegar and in the herb solution. And the difference between those two is bapto temporarily cleans something and cleanses it. But baptizo, when you place that vegetable in the pickling solution, in the vinegar, it literally changes the essence and the nature of the thing that you submerge, the thing that you immerse.
Very interesting.
So I bapto my hands. I wash my hands. I clean my hands. But when I'm immersed, when I'm baptized in water, it's an affirmation. It doesn't get me born again, and we're going to get into that in the scriptures in a moment. But what it does is it affirms and almost agrees in what has happened, that I've repented, I've followed Jesus, I've made a decision to acknowledge that he's the Son of God, that he is God, that he died, that he rose again, and that he paid the way for me. And now I'm alive to God in Christ Jesus. That moment that I make that decision, I'm born again. I'm baptized into the body by the Holy Spirit. But when I'm baptized in water, when I'm baptizoed, it's an acknowledgement of that essence inside me that's changed. That there's a permanent change that's taken place inside me, in my spirit. That I've gone from death unto life. And in addition to that, a part of me has died as well. That word baptizo, a few other definitions of it, means to dip repeatedly, to immerse, to submerge, to cleanse by dipping or submerging, to wash, to make clean with water, to wash oneself, to bathe, to overwhelm, to literally overwhelm something. In the New Testament, we've got a lot of different baptisms that are spoken of. It was John the Baptist, who was a cousin of Jesus, and he went around baptizing Jews prior to Jesus stepping into the foreground as the Messiah, as the Christ, as the anointed one. See, John's baptism, when John preached and people would come down to the Jordan or wherever he was and he would immerse them in water, it was a baptism of repentance looking forward to the moment when the Messiah and the Christ would come. But our baptism now, it's also a baptism of repentance. But it's a baptism looking back. and affirming what Christ has already done for us, that we've repented, we've accepted God's gift in the person of Jesus, and we affirm it in baptism. John was looking forward to the fulfillment of the promise. We're looking back at the promise fulfilled. As an example, in Acts chapter 19, if you guys want to open up your Bibles, we're going to start with verse 1. And I'm going to be reading out of King James. And this is a story of an encounter that Paul had with some Christians in Ephesus. I'm going to go ahead and start again, Acts 19, verse 1. And it came to pass that while Apollos was at Corinth, Apollos, let me explain who he was, guys. Apollos was a teacher and an evangelist in the early church that had an incredible grasp of Jesus and who he was and what was provided through Jesus. And the moment he got a hold of it, he went and evangelized. He was going all over Ephesus, then he went to Corinth, then he ended up going back to, after Corinth, he ended up going to Caesarea and a couple other places, then ended up heading back to Corinth and was an elder at the church there later on. But Apollos kind of left early. He left before the day of Pentecost. He didn't really know about the baptism of the Holy Spirit, but he still went around preaching Jesus. And when he was in Ephesus, let's go back here to 19:1, it says, and it came to pass that while Apollos was at Corinth, Paul, having passed through the upper coast, came to Ephesus. And finding certain disciples, he said unto them, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? They said unto him, we have not so much as heard whether there be a Holy Ghost. He said unto them, unto what then were you baptized? And they said, unto John's baptism. Because Apollos hadn't yet heard about the new baptism, the baptism in water, acknowledging what Jesus had done. He'd been around when John was baptizing people prior to John's death. Then said Paul, John verily baptized with the baptism of repentance, saying unto the people that they should believe on him which should come after him, and that is Christ Jesus. When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of Lord Jesus. And when Paul laid his hands on them, the Holy Ghost came on them, and they spoke with tongues and prophesied. See, there was a difference between the two baptisms, between the baptism of John and the baptism of Jesus, or in the name of Jesus. John's was, again, like I said, acknowledging something that was coming. The baptism that we have now acknowledges something that's already happened. One's looking forward, the other's looking back at the promise fulfilled. In Romans chapter 6, verse 3, Paul wrote, know you not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death? Now this is another image of what baptism is. We were dead to God, and then we became alive to him through Christ Jesus. But our old nature, that Adamic nature, that sin nature, died. And we have a new nature, and we're risen with Christ. And what Paul's talking about here in Romans 6, he says, many of us were baptized into Jesus Christ, were baptized into his death. So as we're immersed, as we make that decision, we are baptized into the death of Jesus and on the crucifixion. Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in the newness of life. So our baptism in water and the immersions in water, again, it's an affirmation of the promise fulfilled, that we've accepted the promise that when we go in the water, that's us being buried, a sign and a type of us being buried. And as we come up out of the water, it's a sign and type of the resurrection, of the newness of life that we have. We're now dead to sin. We're alive to God through Christ Jesus. Our previous Adamic nature has died. We're alive to God. Our old nature, the sin nature, was literally crucified with Jesus, and we rose with him with that new nature. As we're immersed, again, as I said, it's a sign and type of burial, an affirmation that the old man's dead. And it's when we come up out of the water, it's an affirmation of our spirit being alive to God in Christ. Romans 6:10, a little bit later on in that chapter, says, for in that he died unto sin once, but in that he liveth unto God. Likewise, reckon you also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. When we talked about setting our experiences aside and our assumptions aside, and letting the Word of God define who we are and what we are, and our belief system,
There's a lot of popular beliefs in Western culture, and even that's it's permeated into the church. Like there's an old Indian or Native American, not wives' tale, but like saying that we're each born with a good voice and a bad voice on our shoulders, or a good wolf and a bad wolf on our shoulders, and our life is determined by which one we listen to. And people have tried relating that, and when they become Christians, that we've got this old nature, this sin nature that's whispering to us, and we've got the Spirit of God whispering to us. And that's just not true. I'm dead to sin. My flesh might cry out, but my old nature is gone. I don't walk in that old nature anymore because it's dead. I'm a dead man in that way. Amen. And I'm alive to God in Christ Jesus. I have a new nature and my spirit is alive to God. Let me read that again in verse 11. Likewise, reckon you also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Baptism is a really controversial thing in Christianity in a lot of ways. See, we're the body of Christ. We're one body. I mean, each church obviously is like a different separate body. But Christianity as a whole, across the world, we're one body. We're the body of Christ. And when Paul wrote the letter to the Ephesians, there was a lot of stuff going on. Because remember I said Apollos came through Ephesus first. And he's the first one, I think, that shared the gospel, if I'm not mistaken, in Ephesus. And he had those believers that he baptized in the baptism of John. And they started following Jesus. And there were lots of other teachers and leaders in the church, in the first century church. There was Peter, there was Paul, there was Apollos. There were all kinds of people going out and evangelizing. There was Philip, there was Stephen prior to his stoning and his martyrdom. And a lot of people were pigeonholing themselves and saying, I'm a disciple of Apollos. I'm a disciple of Paul. I'm a disciple of Peter. And they were separating themselves and placing themselves in a silo from the rest of the body. And Paul in Ephesians chapter 4 kind of addressed that. He said in verse 4, there's one body, there's one spirit, even as you are called in one hope of your calling. There's one Lord, one faith, one baptism. That one baptism he's talking about is that baptism, that water baptism. Because each of those people that were separating themselves, they weren't aligning themselves with the body of Christ. They were aligning themselves with people that were discipled by the same person. And there was a separation in the same way that, unfortunately, we have denominations today that isolate themselves from other denominations because they might not share the same belief on one particular scripture or one particular belief system. But the thing is, we're one body, guys. We have one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. So there are some churches and some denominations that if you don't baptize in the way that they do, you're not really born again. But we're one body. And there's one baptism. Now, some of the other things that, another question that someone had for me was, why do some people sprinkle? Why do some people dunk? Why do some people immerse? And I've got some explanations on some of that, why some people believe what they believe in the different beliefs. So a lot of the liturgical churches that sprinkle or pour water over someone's head, when they read the New Testament, they look at Peter preaching on the day of Pentecost. And I believe it was 3,000 that got born again that day. And then sometime later, after Peter and John had been lectured and I think beaten by the temple authorities, and they went back to the church and explained to them what happened, and they decided they're not going to back down, that they're going to keep on preaching Jesus. I believe on that day 5,000 were born again. So when they look at those scriptures, they're like, okay, Peter was the man. He was the head of the church at that point in time, and he just led 3,000 people to the Lord, and it says they were all baptized. How in the world is one man
going to baptize all these people. So the belief system on some of those churches or denominations is that the only way to physically do that is that Peter literally sprinkled water upon them. And they're basing that off a couple scriptures out of Ezekiel and also out of some of the Levitical law in the first five books of the Bible. Because when Ezekiel prophesied of the Holy Spirit coming in the future, the words that he uses that the Lord would cleanse us with a sprinkling of water. I think I got that backwards. I'm going to sprinkle you with cleansing water, I think is actually what Ezekiel wrote. And then when the priests were sanctified, when they were set aside, when they went through their cleansing ritual, they were sprinkled with water in the Levitical law. So those churches, a lot of them are looking at it, saying Peter led 3,000 to the Lord, he led 5,000 to the Lord. There's no way he's physically going to go immerse 3,000 people or 5,000. But what they don't remember and what they don't realize is that Peter wasn't the only one in the upper room. Mm-hmm. I mean, there were 10 other of the apostles with him. Judas had already betrayed Jesus and hung himself. But in addition to that, there were all the other followers of Jesus that were there. And all of these people were leaders in the church. So there were a lot of baptizers getting ready to baptize the baptizees. I believe that they immersed them in the same way that John immersed Jesus, in the same way that Philip immersed the eunuch, which we're going to get to in a few moments. But that's where they come, that's where they get the sprinkling idea. That's where they get the pouring of the water idea. Now, just so you know, some of the early church in the first and second century church, they actually sprinkled. But it was of necessity. When the church was under persecution and the Roman government was throwing Christians in jail for following Jesus and not following the Roman gods, those people weren't just keeping their mouth shut in jail. And it was not just Christians in jail. They were leading people to the Lord left and right. Well, when those people started following Jesus, the thing to do was affirm your faith by being baptized. When I'm sitting in a prison cell, there's not a river. There's not a baptismal fount. Right. There's not a place for me to go dunk someone. So they did what was at hand. They sprinkled those people as a sign and an affirmation. But they did it out of necessity and not necessarily out of this is what you're supposed to do doctrinally. So I hope that addresses the question, because that was one of the questions that came up when we had that open discussion about the Holy Spirit and baptism and the different baptisms. So let me get back now to baptism and water. Okay, now we know what it is. It's an immersing, it's an affirmation, but why should we do it? Why do we do it? Because Jesus told us to. In the Gospels, in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, let me cover it first in Mark. Mark 16:15 said, "And he said unto them, Go you into all the world, preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned." And I want to point something out there in that scripture. In verse 16, it says, "He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved." A lot of people believe that you can't be born again unless you're baptized. But it's because they don't read the second half of that scripture. But he that believeth shall not, he that believeth not shall be damned. It's not the baptism that saves us. It's the believing on Jesus. Right. The baptism is an affirmation of it. So does baptism without believing save you? It doesn't. It's kind of like it's a requirement. You need to believe and then be baptized. Because there are some groups, there are some belief systems where they believe that you can take a child or a baby before they're old enough to acknowledge a relationship with God. And they believe if you sprinkle or pour water, that person is then sealed with the Holy Spirit, sealed with that water, that they've been baptized, and that they're born again and they're going to heaven at that point in time. But that's not what Jesus said. Jesus said you have to believe. In Matthew 28, verse 19, it says, "Go you therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost." On the day of Pentecost,
Peter's preaching in Jerusalem. So the Holy Spirit fell, upper room, all the believers that were gathered there, Holy Spirit fell on them. It looked like flames of tongues of fire. They're speaking in different tongues. Peter goes out, he preaches the gospel. And in Acts chapter 2, verse 41, it says, they that gladly received his word were baptized. And the same day, there were added unto them about 3,000 souls. They received the word, and then they were baptized. So baptism itself is not what saves you. You need to receive the word. You need to acknowledge the word. You need to believe on Jesus and what God provided through him. And I know I'm covering a lot of basics, guys, but there were a lot of questions. I want to make sure I'm covering everything that everyone had. Acts chapter 8, verse 12. Philip, he's preaching to the eunuch. It says, but when they believed, pardon me, this is when he's preaching to the Samaria. He was in Samaria preaching, I apologize. So Acts chapter 8, verse 12. But when they believed, now that was the Samaritans, Philip preaching the things concerning the kingdom of God in the name of Jesus Christ. So they believed, they were baptized, both men and women. So they believed Philip's preaching, and then they were baptized. In verse 36, this is later on when he's with the eunuch. And as they went on their way, they came to a certain water, and the eunuch said, see, here is water. What hinders me to be baptized? And Philip said, if you believe with all your heart, you may be baptized. And he said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. So in verse 38, he commanded the chariot to stand still. They both went down into the water, Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized them. And when they were come up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord caught away Philip, and the eunuch saw him no more, and he went on his way rejoicing. Philip challenged him. He said, if you believe, then baptism is appropriate. So believing is a condition. Another scripture that's caused some confusion because it's been taken out of context, and it's caused some confusion, is Acts chapter 2, verse 38. It says, then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. So it says, Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins. Well, that word for, in the Greek, can mean a couple different things. The people that are thinking you have to be baptized to be saved, when they see that scripture, they're thinking, for means you have to believe, be baptized for the remission of sins. In other words, to obtain the remission of sins. But it actually means because you have. So read it this way instead. Peter said to them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ. So they read it to obtain the remission of sins. When it should actually be, repent, be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, because you have the remission of sins.
Awesome.
It's an affirmation of what happened in the repentance and in the believing on Jesus. It's a sign and acknowledgement of salvation and the work that's already been done. Again, John was looking forward. We're looking back. Jesus himself was baptized, guys. It's covered in every one of the Gospels. I'm going to go ahead and read it out of Matthew 3, starting in verse 13. Then comes Jesus from Galilee to Jordan unto John to be baptized of him. But John forbade him, saying, I have need to be baptized of you, and you come to me? Jesus answered and said unto him, Suffer it be so now, for thus it becomes us to fulfill all righteousness. Jesus knew that he needed to be baptized. He knew he needed to fulfill those things that had been prophesied. So John did it. He suffered him. And Jesus, when he was baptized, he went straight away out of the water. And lo, the heavens were opened up to him. And he saw the Spirit of God descending on him like a dove and lighting upon him. And lo, a voice from heaven saying, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Mark wrote in Mark 1, 9 through 11 about the baptism as well, that Jesus was baptized with John in the Jordan. The same thing happened. I'm just going to briefly cover the other scriptures just for those who are watching and for those of you who might be taking notes. Luke chapter 3 and verses 21 and 22 also covers the baptism of Jesus. And John chapter 1 verses 29 through 34. Let me read
the text out of John, again starting in 1:29. The next day, John sees Jesus coming unto him and says, "Behold, the Lamb of God, which takes away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I have said, after me comes a man which is preferred before me, for he was before me." See, all of Israel and the temple leaders and even some of the Romans are like, what's up with this guy, John? They're wondering if he's the Christ. Is he the Messiah? Is he Elijah returned? They had no idea who he was. All they knew is that things were happening and this man was rocking that part of the world. Mm-hmm. But John's like, I'm not the Messiah, but there's one coming after me. There's someone coming. And he knew. I mean, he was cousins with Jesus. He was born a few months before him. He recognized him even from the womb. Mm-hmm. John reacted when he came into the presence of Mary when she was with child with Jesus and John was in his mother's womb. John stirred. John recognized the Messiah is on the scene. So in verse 30, this is he of whom I said, after me comes a man which is preferred before me, for he was before me. And I knew him not, but that he should be made manifest to Israel. Therefore am I come baptizing with water. And John bore record, saying, I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it abode on him. And I knew him not, but he that sent me to baptize with water, and the same said unto me, upon whom thou shalt see the Spirit descending and remaining on him, the same is he which baptizes with the Holy Ghost. And I saw and bear record that this is the Son of God. Amen. So we talked about our baptism into the body by the Holy Spirit. We talked about everything the Holy Spirit is to us. He's a comforter. One that desires intimacy. He's the Spirit of truth. How he walks with us, he reminds us, he shows us of things to come. He reminds us of our righteousness, not of our mistakes, not our sin. It says he came to judge the world because they believed not on Jesus. He came to judge the church of righteousness, meaning to remind us of righteousness. And he came to judge the prince of this world because he's been judged. Mm-hmm. The enemy's been judged. The Holy Spirit is here as our advocate to give us the right words at the right time, to encourage us, to comfort us. And now we're talking about the baptism in water, that affirmation that once we believe on Jesus and we're baptized into the body by the Holy Spirit, that we affirm that by baptism in water. That it's an acknowledgement of that essence change in us in the same way that they washed the vegetable, but then they immersed the vegetable. And when they immersed it, it changed its very nature and its very essence. That when we're baptized in water, it's an acknowledgement that we identify with the death of Christ as we go under, and as we come up, we identify with the resurrection of Christ. Mm-hmm. That our old man is dead, that we have a new man, a new nature that's alive to God through Christ Jesus. Mm-hmm. And John, when he's writing about the other John, amen.
Amen.
In verse 33, he says, upon whom thou shalt see the Spirit descending and remaining on him, the same is he which baptizes with the Holy Ghost. So there's another baptism, guys. There's a third baptism that we're going to start talking about next week. These scriptures lead us right into what we're going to be talking about. You see, something happened at that moment when Jesus was baptized in water. There was a second thing that happened. He went under, he came up. And then the Holy Spirit descended upon him like a dove. He was baptized in the Holy Spirit at that point in time. Miracles began happening. Miracles did not happen in the life of Jesus prior to his baptism in the Holy Spirit. He became flowing in the gifts of the Spirit because after his baptism is when he started gathering his disciples to him. And he had words of wisdom and words of knowledge about someone sitting under a tree and about another individual and another individual. So he started flowing in the gifts of the Spirit that Paul wrote about in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Right after that, when he got back from the wilderness, when he was in the wilderness, the wedding feast of Cana happened and Jesus turned water into wine. So miracles started happening in addition to the gifts of the Spirit flowing. So we're baptized in the body, we're baptized in water, and then there's a baptism in the Holy Ghost. And in that baptism in the Holy Ghost, there's a power available. There's gifts available. It's another separate experience, and that's what we're going to be talking about next week. Another level with the Holy Spirit. So I want to challenge everyone here and everyone that's watching live that if you're born again, well, first, if you're not born again, then I believe the Holy Spirit's been working on your heart to draw you and to show you the Father's love for you. That you wouldn't be watching this live stream, you wouldn't be here tonight unless you were ready to hear it at that point in time. So I want to give you the opportunity to either respond in the live stream or to send us a message or to respond here tonight to acknowledge the Lordship of Jesus. And then if you've already acknowledged the Lordship of Jesus and you haven't been baptized, to make that decision to be baptized in water. And we can arrange that. I'm already in the planning stages of that. If there's anyone that does need to be baptized in water, to acknowledge that new life that's in you, that changed essence, that you've been pickled. And to have an expectant heart for what the teaching is next week. That if you're not baptized in the Holy Spirit, or if you're confused about the baptism of the Holy Spirit, that you have an expectant heart to hear and to see and to know something new about the character of God and how he wants to relate to you and how he wants you to relate to him and to the world around you. So let's bow our heads in prayer and pray with us too. Father, we want to thank you for sending your son Jesus. We acknowledge his lordship. We acknowledge that he was the Son of God. We acknowledge his death, his burial, and his resurrection. That Jesus, you are the Son of God. We repent of our sins. We choose to follow you. Lord, we decide right now to look to you, to think on you, not our circumstances. And to Holy Spirit, to choose intimacy with you. To listen to your voice, to that gentle wind. To listen to your truth, to lean on you and to lean into you. Not just in the bad times, but in the good times. That you're our partner, you're our advocate, you're our comforter, that you're our friend. We thank you, Holy Spirit, that you're here with us now. And that you're going to go with us this week, Lord. I speak a blessing over everyone watching, over everyone that's here. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So thank you for joining us, guys. If you want to join us in person, again, 6:30 every Thursday night at 1537 Chutney Court in Colorado Springs, Colorado. We love you. And share the live stream with your friends. Bye.